work on it, it'll be no more.
You have to turn it on in you.
Bless the Lord. Bless the Lord.
Has he got the mic?
I feel like I've been having a heart attack in the past 2 hours. I'm thankful for this revival. Brother Eddie, he mentioned it to us last year, and he told us, he said, it was better to start praying. And it was a couple months ago. I was up at the state, and we was pushing some snow, and we was kind of a slow night, so we was sitting inside. And God told me about 2:00 in the morning. He said, "You just walk on outside." And I said, "All right." I said, "I don't know why you want me to walk outside, God, but I'll do it." And I walked outside. He said, "Just look up at the stars, amen." And I began to think about how great that He is. And as I looked up at the stars and I looked up at the creation that He had set in front of me, amen, He told me, He said, "You better get ready, amen, because revivals are coming." And I said, "Look over, it's real life." And I'm going to ask you the same question tonight. And I'm going to make the same statement that was made over there several times, friend. I'm hungry tonight. Amen. I'm thankful to be in revival, amen. But as I began to think about the songs that we've heard tonight, I'm thankful that I'm saved, ain't you? I'm thankful that my name is written in the book of life. But I began to listen to that song, and it said, "When I look upon His face," and friend, I always think about how great it's going to be whenever I get to see Jesus face to face. But then I heard the next part, when He takes me by the hand, and I lead me to the promised land. I think about how many times, friend, that I didn't know which way to go in this life. And He's reached down and He's grabbed my hand and He said, "Son, if you'll just follow after me, I'll put you in the right way to go." But I'm thankful that one day, after a while, friend, I'm going to grab onto His hand and He's going to say, "Well done, my good and faithful servant. Let me give you a tour of what I have prepared for you. Let me show you where you're going to rest at forever." All those times that you were mocked, all those times that you were put down, friend, it's all gone. It says in that one song with the saints, with their troubles far behind them, friend. With Jesus, amen. And I'm thankful for that day that's coming, amen. But if you've got your Bibles tonight, will you turn with me to Nehemiah chapter number 1? Nehemiah chapter number 1, and we're going to be looking into verses number 1 through 4. 1 through 4 tonight. And no doubt we're gonna jump around. I do desire your prayers as always, because I know that I'm absolutely nothing, and I can't do nothing within myself. But I do desire your prayers tonight. As we turn into Nehemiah chapter number 1, verses 1 through 4, and we're gonna be jumping around a little bit tonight. But that'll be alright. Says the words of Nehemiah the son of Hakaliah, and it came to pass in the month of Chislu in the 20th year, as I was in Shushan the palace, that Hananiah, one of my brethren, came, he and certain men of Judah, and I asked them concerning the Jews that had escaped, which were led to the captivity, and concerning Jerusalem. And they said unto me, "The remnant that are left of the captivity there in the province are in a great affliction and reproach. The wall of Jerusalem also is broken down, and the gates thereof are burned with fire." And it came to pass when I heard these words that I sat down and wept and mourned certain days, and fasted and prayed before the God of heaven. Now we see at the end of chapter number 1, this is the words of Nehemiah. Nehemiah was the king's cupbearer. And one day that his brother Hananiah and some certain men from Judah, they came to Nehemiah. And Nehemiah, see, he was concerned about the Jews that were once in captivity by Babylon, that had been set free, that had escaped the captivity that they were in, friend. And I don't know about you, but I remember a time in my life I was stuck in captivity, amen. I remember a time in my life when Satan had me bound down, amen. And it seemed like I was in a spiritually dead state with my eyes closed, amen. And there wasn't nothing I could do, and it was dark. But I'm thankful that one day a man named Jesus came home, and he said, "If you'll just follow
over to me, that he will give us a new life. Amen. He'll make you a new creature. It doesn't matter what you've done in your past. It doesn't matter where you're at right now, friend. Jesus Christ wants to come into your life and heal you and help you through the world, the life that we go through. Amen. Brother Ralph was talking a little bit about this world is a battlefield. Every single day of our life it's a battlefield, and if we're not careful, friend, we'll let it weaken us up. Amen. So we see right here that Nehemiah is concerned about these Jews that had escaped, and they're going back to Jerusalem. And he asked his brother and the man that was with him, he said, how are they doing? But see, he didn't get a good report. He said those Jews that have been set free, that are out of captivity, that are back in Jerusalem now, they're under great affliction. They're under a great reproach. The walls of Jerusalem have come crumbling down, and the gates are on fire, friend. And I began to think about those walls and how a wall does whenever through the storms, through the high winds and the heavy rain and the hail and the thunder and the lightning, amen, after a little bit, it starts to get a little bit of a crack. And a little bit of a crack here, and a little bit of a crack there, and soon it becomes a little bit weaker, and a little bit weaker, and then the enemy comes by, and it wants to see Satan is out to destroy you tonight, but the enemy comes by, and then the enemy, let's be smart about this, the enemy doesn't look for the place on the wall that's all clean, it looks like it's just been built, the enemy's going to look for that weak spot in your life. That enemy's going to look for that spot that you struggle with, amen. That enemy's going to look for a place to get you down and try to weaken you day after day, week after week, month after month, and year after year, friend. Satan is trying to weaken Christians today, amen. But we see that that is what happened to these Jews. But see, Nehemiah, it says he had a great concern over these people. Are we concerned with our brothers and sisters in Christ tonight? Are we concerned with them because he saw them in such an affliction and reproach, and it said that he hit his knees and he mourned and he wept and he fasted before the God of heaven, amen, and he prayed and he said, Lord, will you turn your ear towards me? God, will you set your eyes on us? Amen. We've messed up. We've let the world weaken us. We've let the world get us down. Amen. Will you please come help us? Amen. And you see what happens next. Now remember, Nehemiah is the king's cupbearer. He's the king's cupbearer. He's got a job. You've got a job. I'm not talking about let's get away. I'm talking about physically right now. Physically, you've got a job. You've got a life. You've got something you've got to do. Amen. Every day. Amen. We have our lives and we live in. But see, Nehemiah saw these Jews that are in great affliction. And he even prayed and he said, me and my father's house, we've sinned against you, God, and will you forgive us?
Amen.
See, he was honest.
Amen.
He was concerned. But then he said he went to the king over in chapter number 2. He was on his job. And the king saw it. And Nehemiah, he had a heavy heart. See, I had read somewhere that that Nehemiah had actually been praying on the timeline for about 4 months. That he had been praying and fasting and weeping after Jerusalem. And he walked into the king to talk to him for his job. And the king looked at him and he said, what's wrong with you? What's wrong with you? You look fine. I can tell physically you're fine. It's got to be from a heavy heart. It's got to be from a heavy heart. And Nehemiah said, well, how can I be happy? How can I have joy? How can I continue on when my home place, the place that I come from, the place where my father's sepulchers are, it lies waste, and the walls are broken down, and the gates are on fire, friend. You see, that's what's happening today. The enemy is weakening our walls, and it's making destroy you from the inside out. Amen. That's what's going on. And God's people are under affliction today. Amen. And we need to get a heavy heart. But like I said, who's hungry tonight? And I went to the king. And the king said, all right, what do you want to do about it? He said, well, I done prayed to God. Amen. And he showed me what I need to do. So if you'll just let me go, I'll set you a time. But I want to go build it back. Amen. And I come here tonight to build it back. As we go through life, and it seems like your walls are getting weakened. Maybe you feel like you're in captivity. Friend, I'm thankful that there is help in Jesus Christ tonight. Amen. And I'm ready to build it back. I'm ready to get the power of God back in us. Amen. Because the Bible says that the same Spirit that raised Jesus from the dead lives inside of you, friend.
Choice to make at that point in time.
Amen.
Red, I'm here to tell you tonight, we've got a choice.
Yeah.
We've got a choice tonight. Nehemiah said,
yeah.
Of course, he took it to God first, amen, and prayed about it. He said, God, if it be your will, let me to go back. But he said, I'm willing to take time.
Yes, sir.
I'm willing to take some time away from my job. I'm willing to take some time away from my life, amen, and build this wall back up and get some strength about us, amen. And friend, that's what we need to do, not only in this week, but every week from now on. We need to take some time, amen, set some time apart with God, amen, that way that he can strengthen us, amen, and help us through this life. In the times that you get weak, because friend, I'm here to tell you tonight, if you think that you can build that wall by yourself, you are mistaken. Dead wrong. That's right. You are dead wrong. Amen. You can't do nothing by yourself. Amen. You can't do nothing. Satan will destroy you every single time. Every single time.
Amen.
As we've done said, set out to go. They even said that the king had sent some captains of the army and the horsemen with him. But there were some people that wasn't too happy about what they were doing.
Come on.
We see in the second chapter, the 10th verse. By the way, we're going to go into chapter number 4 tonight. And just bear with me. But we see in the 10th verse, it says, when Sanballat, Horonite, and Tobiah, the servant of Ammonite, heard of it, it grieved them exceedingly.
Oh, yeah.
That there was come a man to seek the welfare of the children of Israel. You see, they got word of this, and they didn't want any part of this. They didn't want to see the walls get built back up. They didn't want to see the gates restored. And no doubt as we go through this week and every day of our life, there's going to be people that's not going to be happy, amen. They're going to say, well, why are you even wasting your time driving all the way over to Spielcorn for a revival, amen? Why do you even waste your time trying to witness to somebody on the job site because they don't care about what you're saying? Why do you even try to live a life that is pleasing to Christ? Because it doesn't matter, but friend, it does, amen. It does, amen. And that's what, see, Satan gets exceedingly grieved, amen, when he sees the power of God living inside of us that we can reign over sin. Because, friend, at that time, he knows that he has lost the battle, amen.
hands? Why are you healing the blind? Why are you going into the house of the dead?
Yeah.
Because they're already gone. But Jesus said, no, that's coming back. That's not coming back. They can hear now. They can talk now. They can see now. Amen. And guess what, friend? They're alive and well. Amen. You see, there is nothing. So many times they went and they tried to stop him and they tried to put an end to Jesus' work. Amen. They thought they had him on the cross. They thought they had him when they put him in the tomb. I imagine that Satan could see us down through life knowing that we had no hope, knowing that we had no peace, knowing that we had no joy. And he said, oh yeah, I've done what the Lord now. My friend, as the song said, on the third day, and he came into my life and yours, amen, to break every chain, amen.
I believe it was nighttime. He said that all he had with him. He said he had no other but no beast with him. Except the one he rode in. He couldn't bring nothing with him. He couldn't bring no special tool. He had no special power. He wasn't Superman, friend. He couldn't lift them big rocks and stuff by himself. But all he had was the horse or the beast that said, I don't know if it was a horse or a camel, I don't know what it was. The beast that he rode in. But I began to paint this picture. And if you will, with me, go with me in your minds. I like to visualize things here and there. But I can imagine Nehemiah showing up to the place that he was his home place. Seeing the gates being on fire, seeing the wall that had started to crumble down, and see there was a place that even his beast couldn't go. And he got off and he started walking around. Let's walk around a little bit. Let's examine situation. I believe as that wall was standing in front of him crumbled and weak, that Nehemiah was walking down through there, touching the wall, saying, God, there ain't no way I can do this. It even says over a little later in the next few, in the next couple of chapters, that somebody said that the ashes were so big, that the destruction was so great. Might as well just quit. Might as well just turn around, go back to the king's house, get on back to our daily life. But Nehemiah saw a vision. He knew that the power wasn't within him. He knew that he couldn't pick him big rocks up. He knew that he couldn't do it by himself. Amen. But he knew that the one he had talked with before he ever set out on his journey, when he made the decision to go, amen, that one, the one and only living God, amen, the one that created the whole, the heavens and the earth, amen. I'm pretty sure if he could create the heavens and the earth, friend, that he can build back that wall inside of you, friend. He can still give you strength. There's nothing too big for God. Amen. There's nothing too big. There's nothing too strong that he can't wrap his arms around, that he can't put his hands on. Amen. He can take something that seems so out of reach and so out of mind. Amen. And grab a hold of it and
change it. Amen.
Amen.
Don't ever think that there's something in your life that Jesus can't fix. Amen. Because I'm telling you, the second I was listening to a song coming over here, there's power in the name of Jesus to break every chain. Amen. To change every situation. Amen. To pick up a black and hard heart. Amen. And just wrap his hands around it. Start to soften it up a little bit. And start to speak to it, friend. Amen. He can make you a new creature. And when you are a new creature, everything that you've done in your past, it's wiped clean. He said he cast his hands as far as the east is from the west. Amen. Never to be remembered.
Amen.
We showed up with nothing. We're going to show up with a humble heart. And know that God is in control. God is in control. Now, he had already examined the wall. He looked for the people that was with him. See, God doesn't want us to be alone.
Amen.
Right.
God doesn't want his people to be alone. He doesn't want you to have alone. That's why he walks with you every day. And I'm not saying that he doesn't. He walks with you every step of the way. But he wants us to come together.
Yes.
He wants us to come together in unity.
Yes.
No matter how far the distance, we got people from Tennessee, from Spillcorn. I live in Weaverville, Asheville, other places. But he wants us to come together
in
unity, amen, because there is strength in numbers. Amen. You think about the apostles and the disciples that went and preached the gospel, amen, from one end of the earth to the other, amen. It said that they would gather together and they would rehearse the things that God had done for them, amen. And I no doubt, I mean, everything that they had went through, the good times, I imagine that they sat down and began to talk about how many people they saw saved, and how many people they saw healed, and how many people they saw touched. But not only that, they talked about how many prisons they got through into, how many stones were cast at them, how many times they were cussed out. Amen. We need to come together and be there for one another. Gates are up, our barn with fire, come and let us build the wall of Jerusalem that we may know you. Then I told them of the hand of God, which was upon me, as also the king's words that he had spoken unto me. And they said, let us rise up and build.
Amen.
So they strengthened our hands for this good work. Friend, I'm coming to you tonight. I know I've already said it. But we see the distress that we are in today, amen. We see the world that we're living in. We see the things that the world is taking and making it normal that goes against the word of God. And they're wanting to make it normal, friend. I've already said they're trying to burn our gates down and try to get on the inside, amen. And I'm talking about the world. But see, we've got to establish the enemy. See, it wasn't Sam Ballot and I can't remember the other one's name right now, but it wasn't those two. It was the spirit that was living inside of them. Amen. And that's why when we go out into the world and we see people doing these ungodly things, you need to look past the outward appearance, amen, and who they are and what they've done. And we need to identify the enemy tonight, what is living on the inside, what is reigning and controlling their life, amen.
Yes, sir.
We need to know who the enemy is, because friend, if you don't know who the enemy is, he'll sneak right in them.
That's right.
Right in amongst the all of us. Amen. Kind of fit in, maybe. He uses disguises. Satan uses disguises every single day to try to fit into this thing, into Christianity. But he has these little false teachings, these little false beliefs. Amen. And it works its way slowly into the church.
Come on.
Into the churches. Into the mind of God's people, amen. And if we're not careful, our gates will be burned and our walls will be ripped down.
Amen.
But Nehemiah told him, he said, we need to rise. that's willing to take a stand for what is right and for what is the truth and what is good and what is godly, amen, what is holy, because the Bible says, be ye holy, for I am holy, amen. He doesn't want us to fit in. It says, be ye do not be conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, amen. If we will work, amen, we will rise up and start to build this wall back and get anchored in Jesus Christ, amen. And the devil will not be able to tear it down. I began to think about, see, we did some concrete work back then. And I was thinking about building a good foundation, what it takes. See, you got to form everything up. Where you're going to pour and empty it out. Don't let nothing be in the way. And then you got to take your shovel. We use tractors, whatever now. You got to get that dirt. That dirt that's not solid. That dirt that's kind of freed up. You got to get it off the top. You got to start pulling it back. Get down to that good ground. That good and stable, hard ground, amen. That the Bible talks about the sower seed. That good ground that it talks about. Pull every distraction away. And just like the sister sung a couple weeks ago, Lord, empty me. Empty me of every selfish thing. Empty me of everything that comes into my mind that doesn't pertain to you. Help me to pull the loose soil back and get to the good ground. And then you take that rebar that holds everything together. You start to beat it into the ground. And friend, that is the truth. That is the truth. Jesus says that He is the way, the truth, and the life. The truth is that Jesus came for me and for you and lived a perfect life, amen, and gave His life freely on the cross so that we can have a hope that goes farther beyond the grave, amen. We've got to beat that deep into the depths of our soul, deep into the depths of our heart, amen, and then pour the concrete, which is Jesus also, amen, all over it, because He fills every gap that's in your heart and you can see it from outside.
Amen.
You step up to a big concrete pad, the first thing you see is the concrete. When people look at my life, I don't want them to see me. I don't want them to see anything I've ever done. I want them to see what Jesus has done. Oh,
amen.
Jesus,
amen.
That's how we be.
This thing, will you rebel against the king? I answered them and said unto them, the God of heaven, He will prosper.
Oh,
therefore, we, His servants, will arise and build, but ye have no portion. Now arise, no more in Jerusalem, baby. Friend, if we build tonight, every distraction that comes your way, whenever Satan comes up to you and says that you might as well quit, you might as well lay it down, you better just quit building. What are you going to do? Why are you doing it? That doesn't even matter. Say, my God will provide for me. My God has a home waiting for me for eternity. Amen. And you have no portion. You have no right. Satan, you've got to get on out of here and you've got to flee.
Amen.
See, people don't realize, the people that are allowing the Spirit to live inside them, they don't realize what they're missing out on. You know, at this point, Nehemiah is talking about a physical city of Jerusalem that they're building back up. And he said, you know, once we get this built, this false teaching in today's time that if you just be a good person, if you just be a good person and you just say the right things, then you're going to get a portion, friend. There's people out in the world today that feels entitled to something that they're not going to get. Amen. Unless if you've accepted Jesus Christ into your heart, been born again, washed clean, amen, and made a new creature, friend, started telling them, you better quit or we're going to invade you, and everything that you've done, everything that you've worked for so far, everything that you started building, it's going to be gone. Sometimes in my life, it feels like we're out of
the void.
Yourself up inside these walls, and we ain't gonna be able to get to you. Against the devil without Jesus Christ in our life, I'm going to look.
That's
what the Bible says. The Lord is my rock and my
faith
and my deliverer, my God, my strength, in whom I will trust, my buckler and the horn of my salvation and my high tower. I will call upon the Lord who is worthy to be praised. So shall I be saved from my enemies. I was saying, no, there's nothing I can do to keep you out, friend. But I've got the best friend I've ever had standing beside of me, amen, who is my rock that never fails, that never changes, who is my strength. He's all I've got. He's my high tower that I can look to that cannot be shaken, amen. And he's with me. And devil, you've got to stay out because he's my protector. He's my fortress. He's where we can go to in a time of trouble, amen. And we can hide behind him. He will shelter you from the storm.
Yes, sir.
Amen. Said that they continue building this wall, but they didn't do it unarmed. They said they had their sword girded on their side and continued to build. They didn't slow down. They didn't check up. They didn't stop. They kept that sword on their side the whole time. That way, if the enemy came, they would have something to protect them. Everywhere that we go, we've got to keep the word of God in our hearts. Amen. I love that Jeremiah. He had been going through, we talk about being on a battlefield. Jeremiah come to the point in time in his life where he was so weakened, he told the Lord, he said, I won't make mention of your name anymore. But it said that his word was like a fire burning, built up and shut up inside of his bones. Amen. And friend, I'm thankful that if we put our trust in Jesus Christ tonight, he will be a fire built up inside of you. Amen. That cannot be put out.
Thank you, Lord.
Amen.
Started building that problem. this long, but then it begins to grow. How is it going to grow if we don't spread out? We can't just build in churches. On the job. He's talking about building out in public. And I use it all the time, but when somebody cuts you off on the road and you get a little bit of road rage, amen, we need to start building. Say, Lord, help me not to get weak. Help me not to get weak. I know I'm aggravated right now, but help me not to get weak. You see the group. Some were up top, some were on the bottom, some were over here, some were over there. Nehemiah said, the one that sounded the trumpet was by me. You see, and he told him. He said, if you see the enemies coming, if the enemy start to head this way, if you get in distress, if you start to worry, blow that trumpet and we'll all meet up back up together and we'll unite in this thing, amen, and we will conquer this thing together, amen. That's what we need to do, amen. Whenever you're going through a tough time in your life, friend, sound that trumpet, amen. And the brothers and sisters in Christ will come help you, amen. Sound that trumpet, amen. Because Jesus Christ is not far away. He's living on the inside, amen. Sound that trumpet, and he'll be by your side every step of the way, amen. Sound that trumpet when you think that all hope is gone, amen.
Would you stand with me?